Welcome to this special Harvest at Home Good Friday service.
Being that today is Good Friday, we will have a time of communion at the end of today's service to reflect on what God did in sending His Son to die on a cross for us.
And also, in just a few moments, we're going to share some of the latest projects and resources from Pastor Greg Laurie and Harvest available to you. So maybe during this time, gather what you would like to partake in today's communion portion of the service. This can be any type of beverage or juice, then a cracker or bread, and we'll do this together at the end of today's message.
We'll be back shortly to begin today's service.
What do you want more than anything in this world? Is it money? Power? Happiness? When USA Today asked young people this very question, the thing they wish they had more than anything was to be rich and famous. Deep down inside, we all have a desire to be seen and known. And thanks to social media, everyone can have some kind of fame. Is fame really all that it's cracked up to be? Join me on this journey as we unpack the stories of those who have tasted fame and what they discover on the other side.
Wow, this is a pretty cool life, but at the same time, I knew it was a crazy life.
It becomes a drudgery, and you begin to realize there's got to be something more.
Your life is no longer
success, all the partying, all the money.
The room gets empty and it gets cold.
You think that fame and fortune is going to make us whole.
It's all fleeting. As fame is fleeting.
There must be something better than this.
Today.
Whoa!
Ah, man, the bridge is out.
Welcome to this special Harvest at Home Good Friday service. It's great to have you here with us.
And if you're new here to Harvest, we are so glad that you decided to join us for our Good Friday service. And we invite you to return because we meet here every Sunday for a time of worship and to learn biblical truths from the Word of God. And then you can also join with and connect with others from across the country and the world in fellowship in this live chat room that we have here online.
And today we'll be hearing a special Good Friday message from Pastor Jonathan Laurie. Although Good Friday is the saddest day in our history as believers, we still call it good. Why is that? Well, we call this Good Friday because from it, the greatest good imaginable was the result. Jesus' death on the cross was always a part of God's plan for us. His sacrifice brought us back into a relationship with our Heavenly Father.
And at the end of today's message, we're going to join together for a time of communion and to remember what the sacrifice of God's only Son, Jesus, did for each of us. And we want to encourage all of you to participate with us from wherever you are for this special time of communion. All you need is some type of beverage. It can be juice or water, and then a cracker or even a piece of bread. Again, these are just symbols, so whatever you have available is going to be sufficient for this time. So in these last few moments before we start today's service, feel free to gather these items, and we will do this all together at the end of today's message.
Through our 50 years of ministry, we have developed resources dedicated to helping you in your walk with the Lord. Our website is harvest.org. It has courses, ebooks, podcasts, devotionals, and so much more to help you know God and encourage you to make Him known. Visit harvest.org to get started today.
You know, we always strive to answer life's biggest questions here at Harvest. And there's a statistic that shares that for every second around the clock, some 200 people are entering a form of this question into their search engine: is God real? And so renowned author and good friend of our ministry here at Harvest, Lee Strobel, takes the questions of God's existence head on in his engaging new book titled, Is God Real?
And facing the big questions of life, this fantastic resource is both easy to read and useful to share. And we are offering it as our gift to you in thanks for a donation of any amount that you make today. You don't want to miss out on hearing Lee's research on one of the biggest questions we will ever ask.
And when you give to Harvest Ministries, you are contributing to our mission to know God and to make Him known on a global scale through large-scale evangelistic events, multimedia productions, and numerous resources that are distributed to those who need them most. So in advance, thank you for your generosity and your support in sharing the gospel through Harvest. We're about to start service, so Gabe, would you like to pray for us before we begin?
Yeah, would you pray with me? Father, we just thank you again for another service that we could be a part of, God. I pray, Lord, that you would be glorified in everything that we do. We love you, we praise you, and we look forward to hearing from you now. In Jesus' name, amen.
But the blood of Jesus. Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You've been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You've been so, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found. Leaves a 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away. All the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. When I was your foe, still your love fought for me. You have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid your all for me. You have been so, so
shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me.
No, no, no.
Amen. Well, welcome to our Good Friday service. So glad you guys are all here with us. You can go ahead and take a seat. My name is Adam. I'll be your host today. And as we gather to remember this Good Friday, a day that is meant to commemorate and remember what Jesus did for us on the cross, I want to remind you of the two parties that were involved in the crucifixion, the two primary parties. First, it was God. It was our Creator, our Lord. In Romans chapter 8, verse 32, it says that God was not willing to spare His own Son for our benefit, for our sake. God freely gave His Son to death for our sake. And the second person involved, obviously, was Jesus Christ, remembering that moment the night before He was crucified when He went to the garden, and it says that He sweat, as it were, great drops of blood. Jesus willingly went to the cross on our behalf. This didn't happen because of man's idea. This was all God's idea, and it was His payment for us so that our sins could be paid for and be forgiven. And that is a very good thing to celebrate today. And in a moment, we're going to continue worshiping the Lord through our giving. And this is an opportunity for us to give back to the Lord. God gave His Son, Jesus gave His life, and we today give back to Him in a worship and honor and glory. And as you give today, you are also making it possible for Harvest to continue spreading this message of the gospel throughout the world. And so let's give to the Lord today. There's three ways you can give. You can give online by going to harvest.church/give. You can scan the QR code that's on the screen right now, or you can give as the ushers come forward to receive the afternoon tithes and offerings. But let's pray. Let's ask God's blessing on this time of worship and giving, and then we'll continue worshiping the Lord, and then we'll hear a message from Pastor Jonathan. Let's pray together. Oh, Lord, we are so thankful for Your love for us. It was Your love that caused You to willingly give Your life. It was, God, Your love that You willingly gave Your Son for us. Oh, God, we thank You for that fact. We thank You for that gift. We thank You, Jesus, for the work that You accomplished for us on the cross. We give back to You now. We honor You, we worship You, and we praise You. And it's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Hey, listen, if you've joined us online, you can also click the Donate Now button. Right, that should be on your screen right now. Let's worship the Lord.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Good to see you all. Let's thank our worship team one more time at all of our campuses. You can have a seat. Welcome to our Good Friday service, everybody. I'm Pastor Jonathan Laurie, and it's my honor to get to lead you through this time of remembering the greatest sacrifice ever completed in human history, the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. It's an event that is absolutely marked in history, in eternity, for all of us to remember. We'll be in heaven, and we will still be talking about this sacrifice that Jesus made. You know, growing up, I feel like time used to go so slow. And it just felt like from one Easter to the next, a lifetime of events took place, right? Now, as I've gotten a little bit older, it seems like it's the opposite. What? We're at Easter again already? What? Christmas? What? Summer? You know, kids are out of school again. It seems like time, it just picks up and goes so quickly. But I remember being younger, and yeah, still to this day, I struggle with it, but being impatient. As time used to go by so slow, I was impatient. I wanted things to go quickly. I wanted instant gratification. I wanted it then. I wanted it right now. I didn't want to wait around for things. I remember classes used to take forever. I remember my geography teacher in my sophomore year, he would drone on. He had a monotone way of speaking, and it felt like it took eternity to get through these messages. And so through these, you're like, no, that I feel like it takes an eternity to get through your messages. No, through his lectures. But high school seemed to feel like an eternity, and those classes just seemed to drag on by. And patience is something that I still struggle with. Anybody else here struggle with patience? Yeah, yeah. By the way, welcome to all of our campuses, Harvest Orange County, here at Harvest Riverside, Harvest Online, Harvest on the island of Maui, people hanging out in the amphitheater. I don't know why we have room inside, but you want to hang out in the amphitheater, that's fine. How many of you are coming here from work right now? You're taking a quick little lunch break. That's awesome. God bless you for coming here and making the time to join us for our Good Friday service. But how good did it feel to get out of class when you were in school, to get out of class for recess or when the bell rang and it was the end of the day and you got to go to sports practice or you got to go hang out with your buddies and go get something to eat? How good did that feel? It was always an absolute release, right? It was a good feeling. I remember recently I was out surfing with a friend, and I had to practice some patience. We went to a surf spot that doesn't break very often, and at the end of this jetty, it only breaks a couple times a year, and at the end of this jetty, you can ride a wave, no joke, that is about 1,000 feet long, super, super long wave. The only problem is the takeoff zone is about 25 feet by 25 feet. Very small, and so you also have a lot of people out there, and so what happens is you have to wait your turn. And so as I was waiting my turn, finally my turn came. I sat there for an hour and a half waiting for it to be my turn, waiting for everybody to go. Finally, I was up, so I lined myself up and sat out there, and you can guess what happened next. The ocean went completely flat, completely flat. I sat there chattering in my wetsuit for an hour and a half while the ocean just went completely flat. Now the sun was starting to go down. People were doing what is called the paddle of shame. That's when you paddle in as opposed to riding a wave in. Everybody came to the same conclusion that we just caught the tail end of this swell. And so I finally decided, you know what, I'm going to paddle in. It's done. There's no more. There's only two guys out at this point. It was me and my buddy. And so he paddled in ahead of me and I paddled out or paddled back in. And there was one guy left out there who was like, oh, I'm staying out till dark. And so I get in, and finally I get to the shower, and I'm rinsing off in the shower, and then I just hear the unmistakable sound of hooting coming from the beach. I turn around, and no longer had I been on the beach for 15 seconds, and there's a set that came through, and I was not in the water to get it. One wave, two waves, three waves, four waves, eight waves come through on this set, and you know that feeling. You're just like, of course this just happened. I needed to be patient. I had not been patient. I decided to come in and I missed out. You know, impatience is nothing new. Even people back in Jesus' time were impatient. They were impatient. You think that we have issues with patience today with things like social media, instant gratification. You're bored, you can zonk yourself right out of being bored right away. Just pull your phone out. You want something to eat? Pull up Uber Eats. You can have food delivered to you immediately for an additional fee of $30 per item. But it feels like we are constantly wanting to get things sooner, more quickly, without hesitation, without any delay. And back in Jesus' time, I don't think they had the same access to things that we did, but they too were impatient. Culture and technology had advanced very quickly in the time of Jesus. It had made tremendous leaps in the last couple hundred years with the Roman road system. People for the first time were able to get from one part of the continent to the other on a systematic road system, easy to navigate. They knew how to get there. That didn't exist before that, before the Romans. There was also the Greek language, which became the lingua franca, which means the common tongue. And this is a language that united all of the ancient world. Everybody spoke at least a little bit of Greek, and so you could navigate, you could get around, you could make barters and so forth. Civilizations rose, civilizations fell. The Canaanites, the Babylonians, the Persians, the Greeks, and then ultimately ending with the Romans. Meanwhile, the Hebrew people, they were impatient. They were impatient. They were waiting for their turn to conquer. They were waiting for their leader, their political leader, their Messiah, or what they thought was going to be their Messiah, to lead them out of captivity, just like Moses did with the Hebrew people out of Egyptian captivity. They now wanted to be liberated from Roman captivity. Ultimately, there was Pax Romana, peace by force, as the Romans would do. They would obviously enforce peace with their strength attached behind it. And so they wanted to be Jerusalem. They wanted to be the Hebrew people, but they were under control of the Roman government, and they were waiting for a Messiah. They were waiting for a deliverer. For over 400 years, up to the time Jesus had been born, God was silent to the Hebrew people. No longer was he speaking through the prophets like he had in the past, through Nathan and Elijah and Isaiah and Malachi. And now the Jewish people under this Roman occupation wondered and cried out, "How long, Lord, until our Messiah will come?" Well, the answer was when the time was just right. Or as the New King James says, when the fullness of time had come. Jesus was born of a virgin. Jesus came exactly when, where, and how the prophecies had predicted. Jesus was a fulfillment of prophecy. He was teaching, preaching, healing, rebuking, comforting, correcting, walking, and bringing truth and light into the darkness of the world. But the first Jesus revolution was not going to be a political one. It was going to be ushering in a whole new way to be human. Jesus came not to wear a crown of precious stones, but a crown of thorns. He came not to sit on a beautiful throne of marble, but on a cross of wood. This was all according to plan, God's plan. Unbeknownst to Jesus and his disciples, the moment they'd all been anticipating finally arrived. Jesus would crush the head not of the Romans. He would not liberate them from the Roman captivity, but or any political leader, but ultimately he would crush the head of the devil and he would liberate them from sin and death. God was going to finish what he started, but not in the way anybody had expected. Jesus, the Messiah, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, would suffer and die a substitutionary death in our place and would allow him and allow rather us and his followers to be free from the bondage of sin. My text today is John chapter 19. If you would like to turn in your Bible there, we're going to be looking at John chapter 19, verses 17 to 38. And my message title, if you'd like to take notes, is Born to Die. Born to Die. That is what Jesus was born to do. He was born to die that we might live. So let's read together in John chapter 19, starting in verse 17. And he, bearing his cross, went out to a place called the Place of the Skull, which is called in Hebrew Golgotha, where they crucified him, and two others with him, one on either side, and Jesus in the center. Now Pilate wrote a title and put it on the cross, and the writing was, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Then many of the Jews read this title, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin. Therefore, the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, do not write the King of the Jews, but instead write, he said, I am the King of the Jews. And Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." And then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments and made four parts to each soldier a part, and also the tunic. Now the tunic was without seam, woven from the top in one piece. Let's pause there. Lord, as we begin to examine and look closely at the crucifixion, this radical scene, this horrible and painful moment in your life, Jesus, we can't help but just be in awe of the sacrifice you made on our behalf. Lord, we would not be here today. We would not be gathered here today had it not been for this tremendous sacrifice that you did. And so, Jesus, we worship you. We celebrate you. We would not be calling this Good Friday, of course, if there had not been a resurrection. And so, Jesus, we are thankful for the fulfillment of prophecy that you lived. We're thankful for your teachings. But, Jesus, most of all, we're thankful for the freedom that your death brings to us and the resurrection that we will follow in your example someday. And so, Lord, we ask that you would speak to us through your word now. In Jesus' name, we pray together. Amen. Amen. Again, my message title is Born to Die. Born to Die. I want you to, for a moment, think about how you would like to spend your last few moments on earth. The way that you would like to enter into eternity. If you could write it out today, how would you do that? I think most of us would have a similar idea, maybe a nice room in our house, a familiar space with the windows open and the breeze blowing in, gently blowing the curtains. I think that's been in a few movies, I'm not sure. But laying there surrounded by loved ones, surrounded by friends, people saying nice things to you, complimenting you, telling you what a positive impact you made in their life. I think that's how we would probably all like to pass into eternity. Well, to contrast that, Jesus' death was pretty much the exact opposite of what we would hope for. The complete opposite. It was not peaceful. It was not nice. It was the exact opposite. The crucifixion that Jesus endured was designed for one thing, for suffering. It was designed for suffering. The Persians were the ones that created crucifixion, but the Romans were the ones who perfected it. At this point in human history, there had been about 3,000 men crucified just in the province of Judea, where Jerusalem and Israel was. 3,000 men had been crucified by the Romans. Ultimately, Rome, when they would crucify somebody, it was a way of posting up a big giant sign by the side of the road that said, "Don't mess with Rome." That's what they were saying. Don't mess with us. And so Jesus, his death, it was not private. It was not comfortable. It was not peaceful. It was not surrounded by the people that he loved. It was surrounded by people that were spitting on him and cursing him and making fun of him and challenging him in every way. And so the first thing that we are going to look at, one aspect of Jesus' crucifixion, is number one, it was public. It was public. The Passover celebration was one of the most popular of all the Jewish feasts. It was the most popular of the Jewish feasts. And celebrations that would take place because of the Passover, where they remembered their liberation from being in Egyptian captivity, everybody would come to Jerusalem, and it would swell with over 1 million pilgrims coming from all over the ancient world to celebrate that Passover. The road system next to where Jesus was crucified led to the primary entrance of Jerusalem. And so we see that Jesus was crucified on the busiest highway, leading to the most popular entrance into Jerusalem on the most crowded day of the year. It was public. Jesus would have been crucified naked on a cross for everybody to see, being able to gawk at his beaten and bruised and scourged body, bleeding from his head, with that sign hanging above him, which said, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." People would have come into Jerusalem expecting to hear about this Jesus, this great prophet, hoping to know something about him, hoping to hear one of his messages maybe. Instead, they saw him hanging there, beaten, bloodied, hardly resembling a man. It was public. It was shameful. I want you to think the opening night at the Mission Inn for Christmas light celebration, right? You can't even get through anywhere without bumping into somebody or without finding a parking spot. It's impossible. Or the Newport Beach Peninsula on the 4th of July. There's no way you're getting around there. Or a good bay at the Honolulu Bay over, a good swell over at the Honolulu Bay on the island of Maui. There's just tons and tons of people. That's what it was like. That's what it was like. You couldn't turn anywhere without seeing somebody right next to you. being nailed naked on a cross, raised high off the ground in a place for all to see. It was intentional to inflict as much pain and ultimately shame and emotional suffering for the victim and the family as possible. The crucifixion of Jesus, it was public. Number two, it was painful. It was painful. We tend to romanticize the cross. We have crosses in our homes many times made of beautiful, polished, hard, exotic woods, sanded with, 2,000 grit sandpaper, beautiful to the touch, meant to remind us of the crucifixion that Jesus had. We wear crosses around our necks now. We have crosses tattooed on us. We see crosses everywhere. And hey, they're beautiful things to remind us. But ultimately, the cross was not meant to be a piece of art. It was meant to be a tool for execution. It would not be unlike us having a picture of an electric chair close by and looking to that. No, this was a tool meant for maximum pain and maximum suffering. It was not art at the time. It was a tool for execution. It would have been made of rough, unfinished timber, stained with the blood of other dead criminals. In our text together in John 19, it says just one quick phrase about the crucifixion. This is all it says. There they crucified him. That's the only explanation that John offered about crucifixion. There they crucified him. And that is because at the time John was writing this, it's because crosses with dead or dying men on them were a common sight. Everybody knew what crucifixion was, so no explanation was needed. Crucifixion was not efficient. It was not humane. It was not considerate in regard for the person. And so it was meant to draw out the pain of this person. It was meant for the worst of the worst criminals. Jesus was already on the brink of death before he was crucified, before he was nailed to that cross. The scourging that he endured, where he would have been whipped with a cat of nine tails, a whip that ultimately had strips of leather attached to it with bits of glass and metal inserted. And so when he would be struck with that cat of nine tails in his back, it would rip open his back, exposing vital organs and ligaments. Muscle tissue would have been exposed. His beard was ripped from his face. He would have been punched. There was swelling and bruising. And then, of course, they placed the crown of thorns on his head. He would have been bloody, beaten, and marred, hardly resembling a man. And when he arrived at Calvary, the place of the skull, then he was nailed to the cross. Now, Jesus, he had driven many nails in his life as a carpenter. That was his profession. But now Jesus watched as nails were driven through his hands and through his feet. A single nail was placed through both feet with a small step in between the knees of the prisoner, slightly bent at the foot of the prisoner. There would have been a little step for them to stand on. Their knees would have been slightly bent, and they would have had one nail through their hands on each side. And as the cross was raised off the ground, it would be slid into a hole so that the cross could stand upright, causing all of the weight to come down on those fresh wounds. But with all of that blood loss, all of that pain that was going on, that was not the way that crucifixion killed people. The way that crucifixion would kill somebody was through asphyxiation, basically suffocating, not being able to breathe. You see, as Jesus would hang from his arms, the only way that he could breathe, as he had been just exhausted, anybody who was being crucified, they would slump down and allow all of the weight to come down on the nails that were supporting them. And the way that they would be able to breathe is they would have to push down on that step and rise up, get a breath of air in, and then sink back down. And then they would have to stand up again to exhale that air and bring it back in. It was an exhausting and fatiguing thing to go through. One doctor said, hanging by your arms, the pectoral muscles are paralyzed and the intercostal muscles are unable to act. Air can be drawn into the lungs but cannot be exhaled. Each trip coming up and each trip going down more painful as your back is torn and scraping up and down on that rough timber. It was excruciating, a word reserved for the most extreme pain. That word excruciating comes from the cross. Excruciatus, it means out of the cross. Let's now look at John chapter 19, verse 23 as we continue with the story. And then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, they took his garments and made four parts, to each soldier a part, and also the tunic. Now the tunic was without seam, woven from the top in one piece. They said therefore among themselves, let us not tear it, but cast lots for it, whose it shall be. that the scripture might be fulfilled, which says, they divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. Therefore the soldiers did these things. Now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother and his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciples whom he loved standing by, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." And then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, that disciple took her to his own home. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, he said, "I thirst." That brings us to point number three. It was prophesied. The crucifixion of Jesus was prophesied. Jesus knew all along his life was leading up to the cross. We see throughout Jesus' ministry, he had a phrase that he would often tell people. He would say, "My time has not yet come." At the very first miracle that Jesus did, the wedding at Cana in Galilee, when his mom said to him, "Jesus, they have no wine." He said, "Woman, what does this have to do with me?" He ultimately said, "My time has not yet come." And he would say to the disciples at different times, "My time has not yet come." And he would always tell people whenever he would do a miracle, "Don't say this to anybody. Keep these things to yourself." But of course, they would go out and tell everybody about the miracle that Jesus did or about the word of knowledge he had about their life and what was going on. The reason Jesus said, "My time has not yet come," is because he knew that once he was truly on the radar of the Romans, of the Pharisees, of the people in Jerusalem and in Judea, and they saw that Jesus really was this miracle worker, this amazing prophet, he knew that the clock would begin ticking until the crucifixion would take place. Jesus' entire life was building up to this moment. Everything happened as God said that it would. Jesus' time had now come for the crucifixion. Three times John draws lines back to the Old Testament, saying, "so that the scriptures may be fulfilled." In Psalm 22, David wrote many specific details about the crucifixion of Jesus hundreds of years before this practice was invented, including the thirst that Jesus would experience while on the cross, as well as the casting of lots for his clothing. In the Old Testament, there are 300 prophecies that specify everything that the Messiah would go through, from his birth, his life, his death, his resurrection, his ministry, all fulfilled by Jesus. The crucifixion of Jesus Christ, it was prophesied. And that brings us to number four. It was payment. In order to expedite the process, the Roman centurions and the Roman soldiers would take a club and break their legs of the people being crucified. With legs broken, they could no longer prop themselves up to get a breath, and death would quickly follow as a result of the asphyxiation. Let's read now in verse 29. "Now a vessel full of sour wine was sitting there, and they filled a sponge with the sour wine, put it on hyssop, and put it to his mouth. So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, 'It is finished,' and bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. Therefore, because it was the preparation day that the body should not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for that Sabbath was a high day, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they may be taken away. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and the other who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and immediately blood and water came out. And he who has testified and his testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth so that you may believe. For these were done that the scripture should be fulfilled, 'Not one of his bones shall be broken.' And again, another scripture says, 'They shall look on him whom they pierced.'" The death of Jesus was payment for us. It was payment for us. This is the reason why Jesus was crucified. It was not because he committed a crime. It was not because of the religious leaders delivering him ultimately up for some false accusation that they manufactured and blew out of proportion. No, the reason Jesus was crucified was to pay for our sins, not because of a misunderstanding. Jesus' crucifixion was payment for your sin. It was payment for my children's sins. It was payment for your grandchildren's sins. Jesus was born to die. His very life's purpose was payment for us. It's been said that it was not nails that held Jesus to the cross, but it was his love for you and for me. He could have come down from that cross. He could have stepped down. He could have called down a legion of angels to come and wiped out every single person that mocked him and spat on him and cursed him and beat him. But he chose to remain there because he knew that his life had a purpose, and it was to pay for our sin and to ultimately liberate us from death and from sin. Verse 30 says, "So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, 'It is finished.' And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit." The word that Jesus would have said here was tetelestai. Tetelestai. Some of us know that word. It simply means it is finished. It is finished. But not in the sense like my life has come to an end, but it is finished. The job is complete would maybe be a better translation. It was a word often used by workers that would work and build a home, or they would build a chair. Jesus being a craftsman, a carpenter, he would have used this term many times. Hey, you know, I just want to let you know that that chair or that table or that building that you asked me to build, it's finished, it's complete. My part of the job is done. Tetelestai. Well, in the same way, Jesus said, the work I have come to do, the process of forgiveness, the process of reconciliation to God is complete. Tetelestai. There is nothing else that needs to be done. There's nothing else that needs to be added. The work is complete. This was not the dying words of a man who was suffering on a cross. It was a victory cry over sin and death. And that is what Jesus said, tetelestai. The reason we can celebrate the horrific and heartbreaking crucifixion of Jesus, the reason we can call this Good Friday, is because the tomb of Christ is empty. Amen? The tomb of Christ is empty today. It is the only tourist attraction that people line up to see something that isn't there. People line up today. I've been there before. They wait in line to go and look into the tomb as though there is something there. They know there's nothing there. The tomb is empty, and it has been for 2,000 years. Muhammad is dead. Joseph Smith is dead. Buddha is dead. Charles Darwin is dead. But Jesus is alive. And that's why we're able to say it is Good Friday. Jesus willingly went to the cross because of his love for you and for me. Hebrews 12 tells us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For the joy that was set before him. Do you know what the joy that was set before him was? What was this joy that he was looking forward to, that he was anticipating, that he was enduring this suffering for? It was you, friend. It was you. You were the joy that was set before Jesus. He was thinking of you. He was thinking of how he was going to deliver you from the depths of hell and into his Father's house. That's what Jesus did for you. You were the joy that was set before him. The night before Jesus was crucified, he was with the disciples in the upper room, and they had what was called the Last Supper, and they observed communion for the very first time. And Jesus took the bread, and he took the cup, and he told the disciples, "Do this in remembrance of me. Drink this cup, eat this bread. This is my body, this is my blood. Do these things in remembrance of me." The Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians exhorts us also that we are to do this to proclaim the death and the resurrection of Jesus. One of the things that Jesus commands us to do is to remember him by receiving communion, and we are going to do that together right now. You might think that, you know, as you've come here, I'm going to come to Good Friday service. It's my time to come to church. You know, I usually come two times a year, Christmas and Easter, and, you know, it's my time to get a little religion. It's time to check in with the man upstairs, the big man, and let him know that I'm still part of the team. And, you know, we haven't talked much lately, and so I like to come and receive communion and, you know, sing the songs and hear the story. Well, that's great, and we're glad that you're here. But I want to let you know that this is more than just a religion. This is more than just going through the motions. This is more than just coming to church once or twice a year. What Jesus came to do was to establish a relationship with you. And this time of communion, it is not something that necessarily brings you closer to God if you were distant from him, or if you were an unbeliever, or you are in an unworthy state. Receiving communion in an unworthy manner will actually eat. You are eating and drinking judgment unto yourself, we are told in Scripture. That's right. if you receive communion, if you take the elements and partake together with all of us, and you are in an unworthy manner, you are eating and drinking judgment to yourself, which is kind of a heavy thing to think about. And so I would tell you today that if you are going to receive in an unworthy manner, allow those elements to pass by you. You will be better off not taking those things. But I have an alternative for you, and I think you knew this was coming. And that is that you could get right with Jesus. That is that you could call out to him and you could ask him to forgive you of your sins. And then you could partake of communion in a worthy manner, in a forgiven manner. And so today, this Good Friday, as we talk about the crucifixion, we talk about how it was public, it was painful, it was prophesied, and ultimately it was payment. That was for you and that was for me. Jesus did everything he could to get you into heaven. All you have to do now is receive it in faith. Receive this free gift. And so I invite you to pray this prayer and invite you to receive Jesus Christ. Would you join me in prayer? Lord, we thank you for your love for us. We thank you for what you have done. We thank you for who you are. Lord, we confess that we have fallen short, that we have sinned, that we have messed up time and time and time again. But Jesus, you are enough. Your death was enough for us. It was the propitiation, the perfect sacrifice needed to pay for our sins. We earned ourselves hell. We earned ourselves separation from you, God, but you loved us, and we thank you. All we can do is say thank you and remember the sacrifice that Jesus made on our behalf. And so our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed, and we're praying. There may be some here today at all of our campuses and locations watching that have not yet put their faith in Jesus Christ. Listen, I would extend to you this invitation. Believe in Jesus. Believe in his death. Believe in his resurrection. Believe that it is enough to pay for your sin. Put your faith in him today, and he will make you a new creation. All you have to do is call upon the name of the Lord and believe in him. And so if you would like to do that, I would invite you to pray this prayer wherever you are. Just pray this out loud after me. Pray this now. Dear God, I know that I'm a sinner, but I know that Jesus is the Savior who died on the cross for my sin. And I turn from that sin now, and I turn to you from this moment forward. Help me to walk with you. Help me to talk with you. And help me to hear your voice. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you that prayed just now. Amazing. And welcome to your first communion service. Listen, what's going to happen right now is at all of our campuses, all of our locations, the band's going to play a song. And we have our pastors and leaders up front right now, and they're going to distribute the elements. They're going to give you the bread and the cup at the same time. And so please make sure you grab both elements. Once everyone has been served, we will pray together, and then we will partake of each element together. And so please wait until everybody has had an opportunity to be served, and then we'll partake. Let's worship the Lord together.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The Father turns his face away. his wounds have paid my ransom. But this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
Amen. Well, as we hold in our hand this bread, this unleavened bread, we see that it's not fluffy like a normal piece of bread. That's because it doesn't have yeast in it. And the reason we eat this bread without leaven, this bread without yeast, is because Jesus talked about how sin was symbolic of leaven. He said, "Beware of the leaven of the Pharisees." Jesus was without sin. He never committed a sin. He never committed one single sin. He lived a perfect life. And so as we hold in this, hold our bread in our hand, we're reminded Jesus was sinless. He lived this perfect life. He died the perfect death. And we see that Jesus took that bread and he broke it. And we're reminded that Jesus' body was broken for us. Isaiah 53 says, "He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities, and upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds, we are healed." Jesus came to heal not just physically, but spiritually. But we also know that there are some here today, and those who are watching online who are experiencing physical pain, who are experiencing physical suffering, and there's an affliction. You got a bad report from the doctor. I want to tell you today that if you're facing an ailment, if you're facing something, Jesus is the great physician and he can heal you. Even today, Jesus did not just come to heal us of our spiritual sin, but also our physical, our spiritual death, but also our physical. Jesus can touch you. He can heal you. He can fix that thing that's going on inside of you, but you need to ask him in faith. And so as we pray and partake of this, think of that thing that you are going through and commit it to the Lord. And we're going to ask him that he would touch you and extend a special healing today. Let's pray together. Jesus, you are the great physician. And Lord, we just ask that anybody here who might be going through a physical affliction, Lord, that you would touch them, that you would heal them even now. Lord, we thank you that you have come to give us life and life more abundantly. You gave us joy. You gave us peace. You have healed our sins. You have given us the hope of heaven. And that is the greatest healing of all. That's the greatest miracle of all, is that you, who knew no sin, became sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God. So Jesus, we pray that you would touch those that are here today, that need that physical touch, that need that physical healing. Lord, yes, you can touch them. We believe it. And so we pray that you would do that. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's partake. Next we hold the cup. We read in Matthew 26, "And Jesus took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, 'Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom.'" And we remember the blood that Jesus shed. It's symbolic. The cup of God's judgment was poured out on Jesus completely, totally, so that we would not have to experience this judgment. Jesus took it all. He allowed it to all be taken upon himself, and he drank of that cup. And so we remember. Jesus, we now, as we hold this cup, the precious blood that poured from your nail-pierced hands and feet, the crown of thorns that you were forced to wear, and all of that blood that poured from your body, we know that you shed that blood for us. Because we're told again in Scripture, without the shedding of blood, there can be no remission of sin. There must be a payment for us. And Jesus, you laid your life down for your friends. Greater love has no man than this. And so Jesus, we remember, we celebrate, and we are grateful. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's partake. Amen. Praise the Lord. Happy Good Friday, everybody. Thank you for joining us.
What a great message from Pastor Jonathan in a time of communion. You know, if you prayed today to ask Christ into your life, we want to welcome you to the family of God.
We are so happy that you have made this decision to follow Christ, and we want to help you get started in your relationship with Him, or even restarted. And we want to send you a new Believer's Bible, which presents the New Testament in a very understandable translation and has hundreds of notes from Pastor Greg Laurie.
And let us know you prayed by clicking the link, or you can go to harvest.org/Bible, and we would love to send you the new Believer's Bible for free.
Well, we're so glad that you were able to be with us today, and we invite you to come back this Sunday for Easter services right here at Harvest at Home for the sunrise service at 6 a.m. or come to one of the later services beginning at 8, 10, or 12. And remember to invite someone who may not know the Lord to join you. You can send them the link, which is harvest.org/live. Well, God bless you guys, and we will see you on Sunday. You are good, you're good, oh.